here's the most surprising part of the entire experience. There is no one on the planet that has all of the code that goes in an automobile.
Your car company these days is just an integrator putting together all these parts from different manufacturers. It absolutely creates a security problem.
It starts in late 2007, and Yoshi had been working on some really neat work.
I think what has prepared me most for working in automotive security is all the work that I've done looking at security for other emerging technologies.
And I said, hey, I bet there are similar kinds of security issues in all of these other kinds of devices.
And automobiles were definitely one of those.
So I think it was Stefan who cornered us, asked us, hey, are you interested in trying to hack a car? And we're like, sure.
So the team at the University of Washington were PhD students at the time, Karl, Koscher, Alexei Cheskis, Francisco Rossner. As a team, we called Karl the car whisperer.
On the San Diego side, Brian Cantor, Danny Anderson, Damon McCoy, and then Steve Checkoway.
Stefan approached me. His pitch was, let's buy a car and see what functionality in the car we can control.
To my memory, no one in the team knew anything specific about cars prior to us starting.
I grew up in New York City. I learned to drive when I was 28.
And that involved a lot of research and figuring out, like, okay, what is under computer control?
So modern cars are almost completely computer controlled. Everything from the door locks to the steering to the brakes.
But they need to talk to each other because when you are hitting the brakes, the stability control unit needs to know that you're hitting the brakes and the engine controller needs to know. And rather than draw wires between all of them, they started building networks in the cars that connected everything to each other.
We landed on what was probably one of the most computerized cars at the time.
They were 2009 Chevy Impalas. So our car was called Vlad the Impala. There may have been a name for the UW car, I don't remember.
We couldn't top that name, so we just settled on Emma.
First, there was a period in learning about automotive electronics and the history of it.
We ordered the dealer service manual. It's about, you know, this tall.
We noticed really early on just how many messages were being sent back and forth between the computers.
And so what we did in the beginning, because we really did not understand very much, is we just plugged in and looked at the messages.
And we listened. And we did things like we pressed the brake pedal and we saw what message was sent. And we turned on the lights and saw what message was sent. And over the course of that process, we were able to learn the language that the car spoke. And then we started to develop the ability to speak that language ourselves.
The CD exploit was actually one of the things that took us the longest to figure out.
We could take a normal piece of digital music,
Beethoven's Symphony No. 9,
change it slightly. It'll still play fine on your laptop, but if you ever took that song and played it in our car, it would take over the car.
One of the other ways that we could get into the car was through OnStar service.
It turns out that our car has an internal cell phone.
We were able to call the phone in the car from anywhere in the world and play a specially crafted sequence of tones.
That sounds kind of like a fax machine on steroids, you know.
And then from there, take control of the entire rest of the car.
So one of the absolutely critical parts of this research was to understand and experiment with the vehicle in actually real driving situations.
My first idea was using the I-5 express lanes here, which are closed overnight, but it turned out it was easier to acquire use of a decommissioned airport. They still had the runway there.
Alexei Cheskis, one of the students at the University of Washington, volunteered to drive the car for these experiments.
Decked out in his motorcycle safety gear.
He was eager, because I think we would not have asked anyone to do it. There were a lot of lawyers involved.
We had a number of safety precautions in place.
Like fallback things to disable the vehicle if something went awry. The police escort, the whole nine yards.
Other team members were driving along beside him in a different car.
I had my own laptop, which was connected over Wi-Fi to the laptop in the car to sort of simulate a remote attacker.
The brakes would get turned off or the brakes would get turned on and we would make him skid.
It was kind of Mythbusters-y.
When we first demonstrated this for the folks from GM, we had the car outside the window. We call the car, and then all of a sudden the car outside starts honking its horn, and the windshield wipers are going, and the fluid is shooting off, and they were convinced that there was an issue.
GM started a whole product security organization, and we're hiring people like crazy to actually develop cybersecurity.
The car that we used was a GM car, but it was absolutely not a GM problem. The way the whole automotive industry supply chain worked, that was shared by all the manufacturers.
And our goal was to help make the world a better place.
And I think that the work that we did, while it had the largest impact in the automotive industry, actually definitely was a wake-up call for a number of other industries as well.
I would actually make a call for the research community to think about what are the other technologies that are incredibly integrated into our lives, but they have not received the security analysis that we gave these automobiles, and to think about what the risks might be with those technologies and how we can proactively secure those technologies as well so that they don't become a risk in the future.